Hi, thank you all for joining me today. My name is Pete Besson. I'm a second year master's student here at SIU. I worked with larval, juvenile yellow perch. Today I'll mostly just be taking you through the system I use for this process, sort of the technical aspects of an indoor system and general overview of rearing, specifically yellow perch in an indoor system. So first off, we collected our eggs from a pond. We transferred them back from the pond in a cooler using aeration. Shortly after we acclimate the eggs, 2 to 3 hours doing this, kind of mixing the water slowly to match that temperature in the system. And from there, our eggs go into the hatching jars. The water flows in through these black pipes, down into the eggs, and the flow of water sort of mixes the eggs in there. And from there, the water flows out into our glass aquaria, where we have hatching bags which catch the larvae, so they don't escape to the outlets. One thing we pay attention to closely is periodically mixing these eggs with these downspouts. Sometimes there'll be low areas of oxygen within the little crevices of these egg ribbons. So something to monitor definitely multiple times on a daily basis. As well, the temperature we closely monitor. We kept our system at about 52 degrees Fahrenheit for 10 to 14 days. This is pretty common. We can influence the absorption of their yolk sac using the temperature slightly. So keeping close attention to the temperature is important in terms of how long these eggs are going to be in the system, and really monitoring those eggs and those newly hatched larvae is crucial to stocking them into the rearing system at the appropriate time. These are just a closer look at the hatching jars. I found a couple prices from Global Aquaculture Supply and Pentair. You can scan the code if you'd like to look more into it. I know the Global Aquaculture Supply, I called them and they said you could get a pallet price, which was about 40 jars for $100 a unit, as opposed to 110 or 150. So when we're looking at the larvae once they hatch into the hatching bags, we know that it can take about 5 to 10 days for them to absorb the yolk. So we're constantly monitoring them, just using a beaker. So we'll scoop some up into a beaker and observe them using these handheld microscopes. And what we're really looking for is for them to absorb this yolk sac. So here on the right, when they first hatch, they have this bigger yolk sac. Next few days, they slowly absorb this, slowly absorb it. They get skinnier and skinnier, and this is kind of what it looks like on the microscope. I know it's a little hard to tell, but you can see their yolks. This one over here on the left is pretty large. It's newly hatched. And then these two on the right here are a few days in. They've started to absorb. They're getting skinnier. This one over here on the far right is much skinnier compared to this one on the left. And what we're looking for finally is the swim-up behavior. So once we have them in the beaker, maybe on day 7 or so, you might see a few swimming up. So what we're looking for when we are ready to stock is the swim-up behavior, and we really want to see a majority of the larvae present this behavior. So this one here is a really good example. It's really skinny. It's used up all its yolk sac, so it's looking for food in the water column. It's up off the bottom. You can see some of these a little harder to see. They're kind of lifting up off the bottom and starting to look around. So once a majority of these larvae have done this and you observe it, the system's ready to stock with these larvae, and feeding can begin. So going over the basic components of our rearing system. First off, we have here just our water chiller. This will keep our temperature where we want it. We'll go over that sort of specifics in a moment. But we have a pump supplying water to this, returning. We have two pumps here supplying water to the system. These two pumps here go through sand filters, which filter out those larger solids, while the biofilter here filters out those nitrogen components. As well, we have aeration pumps and pumps to inject clay into the system. And really, the main focus here is just to consider all the electrical requirements that you'll need, where you want your outlets at, where you can put an outlet, where you can put a pump to not be overloading that system just electrically. We have some problems here at SIU in terms of running out of outlets to use, or not being able to plug a pump in somewhere because the electrical just won't support it. Outlets trip as well, so we want to make sure we're monitoring that, especially the thio pump. We don't want that to trip and not supply thio to the makeup tank. That would result, obviously, in chlorine being input into the system, and quick mortality for whatever production you're doing. As well, we have treated water over here, just to replace that water even faster. It's nice to have treated water tanks. These are 1,000 liters each. So it's nice to have those ready to go when you need it in terms of replacing water that's heavily full of solids and nitrogen components. As well, we have lights over the tanks. These kind of are feeding cues for our fish, so we'll turn them on during feeding and dim them down at all other times. We'll go over some of those more over the tank components shortly here. Lastly, when we're stocking, we want to try to feed our biofilter here a couple weeks prior to stocking if you can. A week before is okay, but if you, the earlier the better, the stronger biofilter you can have when you stock, just the better in terms of how much you're going to be feeding, how much nitrogen is going to be building up in the system. So when we think about filtration, our first line of filtration is mechanical filtration. We just use these pool filters here, kind of fine sand within these things that catch those larger solids. One thing when installing these is to think about the turnover rate. So how many times per day can your system flow through these filters and be filtered per day? Ours here happens to be around 27,000 gallons every 12 hours. So about twice a day, our system passes through these filters completely. Another thing to think about daily is back flushing, so essentially rinsing these filters out and out of the system. This is critical to maintaining your flow. If you lose flow to one of your tanks, this will kill your fish very quickly. They'll lose oxygen. And so checking these daily, rinsing them out daily is critical to maintaining that. As well, when you're installing the filters, it's important to think about if you can any modifications that you might make in the future. So you don't have to think of the modifications you're going to make, obviously, but having the room to make them, having the ability to make them through the use of either unions or simply just having the space to do it, can be helpful. And here's just a couple other filter prices I found online. You can see anywhere from $600 to $1,000 here. As well, there's different ways to backflush them. We have both of these systems here in the lab. Personally, I like these slightly more expensive ones. They're just much more resilient. They're not as fragile as these slightly cheaper version here. This one's a little more prone to breaking as well. The seals sometimes have burst on us. Haven't had any problems with these ones that are just slightly more expensive, but haven't ever had to fix them or mess with them, at least in my experience here. Just the media that goes inside these filter systems, inside the sand filters, we use this Ruby sand here. It's a standard swimming pool filter media. Other filters, we'll use these plastic beads here, kind of same process of catching those larger solids in the system, same process of back flushing. As well, our biofilters use this plastic media here to sort of create a surface for that bacteria to grow and filter out those nitrogen components of the water. And so a biofilter, as I mentioned, we want to try to build this up prior to stocking our system. If you can do it a week or two ahead of time, that's great. And we'll just trickle the water through the biofilter. It creates these anaerobic conditions. So different colonies of bacteria will grow and filter out that nitrogen components differently for the system. And they don't have to be expensive. We use a leftover tank here filled with this media, trickle the water through for one system. In our larval system here, we just use this corrugated piping, trickle the water through, and the media is filled up in these pipes directly over the sump. So our light control of the system, we have a few different measures for doing so. We have this gardening textile over the facility lighting to sort of dim that light, ambient light in the whole building, as well as over our tanks, we have these tarps to filter out any more of that ambient light that we need to. Over the tanks, we have LED lights mostly for feeding cues. We just want to turn these on when we feed to sort of build this cue to come up and feed. The larvae are attracted to this light as well. So having them something that above the tank that they're attracted to, we think helps lead them to food as well. We also have sprinklers over our system, and this helps with swim bladder inflation. It breaks the surface tension of the water and allows those larvae to really gulp air during those first few days of swim bladder inflation. These 45-degree angled ones also help with flow. These sprayers also inject clay into the system, so this minimizes clinging behavior and reduces cannibalism. Clinging behavior is sort of this behavior where they'll cling to the edges of the tanks. They're usually stressed out, they won't eat, and it's sort of a function of that light refracting off the water, as well as walking by the tanks. Your shadow changes the conditions of lighting in the tanks. Additionally, reduces cannibalism, so this will stress out fish. You'll inevitably have cannibals in your system. You want to remove those as quickly as possible, if you can. And this clay sort of mitigates some of that stress induced by these cannibals. So as I mentioned, these sprinklers allow for gas exchange and efficient simulator inflation. They also inject the clay, and so sometimes they do clog, and that's why we use these quick connect ones. They can be found here. They're about $4 a piece, but really worth it in terms of being able to pop them on and off, clean them, and get them going again. Really worth the payoff in terms of efficient swim bladder inflation. During both my studies here, we got 100% swim bladder inflation across the board. So we think these are a lot to thank for that rate and efficient swim bladder inflation. In our system, we also have variable mesh screens. So as the larvae get bigger, we're increasing these mesh sizes. Obviously, not big enough to where the larvae can escape, but the larger the sizes we can have on our screens, the easier we can remove our solids out of the tank. The better our water quality will be. But to start, during our first days of stocking, we'll have these variable mesh sizes. So this lower portion below the water surface is 0.5 millimeter, and above is 1 millimeter, and this will allow for that passage of oil that'll build up on the surface either from feed or from that swim bladder inflation process during those early days. We also have laminar flow, so nothing too complex here, just an inlet pipe drilled with holes. That allows for laminar flow in the tank, just attached at a 90-degree angle. And this will just prolong the availability of feed. It'll allow for that feed to sink a little slower. As well, we'll add salt to the water, just 2 to 3 ppm. And this will prolong the viability of that live feed, the marine organisms. So even that slight increase in salinity will increase that viability of the feed just slightly longer. So our Teami recipe, as I mentioned, the marine organisms. So having that 2 to 3 ppt in your water can prolong the viability of these feeds. For this recipe specifically, it's 6.5 liters. This cone is around 7 liters. We'll fill the water up to this line. No need to remove the chlorine or anything. They can hatch with it in the water. From there, we'll add 160 grams of salt, 5 grams of sodium bicarbonate, and then our 7 to 8 grams of Artemia. So once our cones are prepared, we'll put them in a water bath at 28 degrees Celsius for 18 to 24 hours, aerating them vigorously under lighting. So overhead we have lights here, we have our aeration hoses, and our water bath. And we have 3 different cones here. They've all been placed at different times. So here on the left we have one that's just been placed. You can see it's kind of tan. And then here we have one in the middle, about 12 hours along. It's getting orange. You can see some of that Artemia has started to hatch. And then over here on the right, we have one that's pretty much ready. It's been going for about 20 to 22 hours. It's ready for the next step in actually collecting that Artemia. And so from here, we removed our cones from the water bath. We removed our aeration. Again, placed lights to sort of encourage those Artemia to swim towards it. As our cysts separate, we're essentially just waiting 1 or 2 minutes for those cysts to sink to the bottom. And we'll try to capture this lighter orange area up here, making sure to keep our siphon off the bottom and away from these dark cysts. And so as we pass our water through our filter, we want to try to avoid seeing any of these dark colorations here. We really want to shoot for this bright orange color down here in our filter, and this is what we'll end up feeding to our fish just directly into the water. So now that we've harvested our egg ribbons, incubated our eggs, watched our yolk sacs absorb, as well as observed for swim-up behavior, we prepared our live feed, our Artemia, and prepared our biofilter in the system. Our system's running. This next video will just sort of show what that looks like, fully set up. So just the one feeding regimen we had from one trial, we used rotifers and Artemia from first feeding. So from 9 to 10 days post-hatch, we used rotifers. From 11 to 12 days post-hatch, we used Artemia. Then rotifers, so during that transition period. And then from 13 to 15 DPH, we use just Artemia. From 16 to 19 DPH, we use Autohime, or a dry feed, during that transition. And then from 19 to 32 DPH, we were doing only dry feeds, Autohime. And so during these transition days, one thing we want to think about is just always encouraging them to eat that next feed. So when we're transitioning to Artemia or dry feed, we want to introduce it. Before the Artemia, you want to encourage them to try that new feed and get on that next nutrient dense formulation as quickly as possible. We're feeding the live feeds 4 to 6 times a day. One thing to do to evaluate if the larvae can receive that next size of feed is to put them in a beaker again and sprinkle some of that feed in and just observe them a little more closely if they can see if they can fit that feed in their mouth and really ingest it and digest it. And here's just what the fish look like in the black tanks after we fed them. So you can see, majority of them have orange bellies. They're full of artemia. We really shoot for seeing around 95% of these orange bellies. You don't want to see patches of clear fish with empty stomachs. You want to feed until you see most of those fish, full of artemia. And on the right here, it's a slightly later in the production. Our fish are slightly larger. You can see the bottom of the tank here is pretty clean. We want to keep those tanks clean every day, really siphoning out that old feed and early mortalities as often as we can. And then keeping these fish as full as possible during these stages. So filling them up until they're swimming around satiated, full of feed, constantly throughout the day as much as you can. And then since we are indoors, we want to take advantage of being able to monitor these fish very early from a young age. Generally, stressed fish will not eat. And so when you see stressed fish, there's a couple things you can check first: temperature, pH, dissolved oxygen. Here's sort of the general ranges for these yellow perch, as well as many other aquatic species. As well, making sure your flows are adequate, chlorine pumps are working. Chlorine loss of flow are quickly result in mass mortality. The loss of flow, especially at high production levels, will quickly reduce your oxygen levels, and that'll kill your fish very quickly. As well, removing any mortalities and leftover feeds on a daily basis. It's a lot easier to mitigate fungal infections than it is to treat it. And so removing these mortalities and leftover feed is important to having healthy, happy fish.